Welcome, sisters and brothers, to the Associate Pastor's Parsonage. More importantly, though, welcome to this time when we recenter ourselves, when we become refreshed and renewed by being met by God in this time, in whatever place we happen to be. Before we begin worship, though, I would like to ask you all to please complete the email survey that was sent to you last Monday. We should have one response per household. The information that you provide will help us to know how we can best prepare for the time when we will be able to gather together and worship in person. So I encourage you, if you have not yet completed that, to please do so. Now, let us turn to the one who wants to carry our burdens, the one who wants to bring us peace and rest.
Would you join me now in this call to worship? Come, all that are weary, all that are carrying burdens so heavy, Jesus will give us rest. Come, take what Jesus has to offer: love, forgiveness, grace. Christ will give us peace. Come, find rest and learn from Jesus. For our Savior will give us rest in our souls. Come, let us worship our God. Let us follow our Savior, who leads us into life. Let us sing together. Friends, in just a moment, we are going to pray together a prayer written by Shane Claiborne and Jonathan Wilson Hartgrove. And I'm going to invite you to pray it out loud along with me. We've been doing this throughout our time together, connecting virtually through this pandemic, as a way of staying connected. Being connected is important to us, especially important during this season. It's one of the reasons we continue to film ourselves at various locations around the building, so that there's that sense of being connected to the space where we once gathered together. In fact, as we read these prayers out loud, as we speak them out loud, even amidst the awkwardness of saying them with our families on our couch or all by ourselves in front of a screen, we remember that these words connect us. We may even remember where we would sit sometimes in our sanctuary and hear the voices of those around us with whom we would join together in saying these prayers out loud. It's an opportunity for us to use our voice during this season and to connect it to the voices of other people. So speak aloud or listen intently, but do so knowing that this liturgy is indeed the work of the people, connected in community. So let us pray. Lord of creation, create in us a new rhythm of life, composed of hours that sustain rather than stress, of days that deliver rather than destroy, of time that tickles rather than tackles. Lord of liberation, by the rhythm of your truth, set us free from the bondage and baggage that breaks us, from the pharaohs and fellows who fail us, from the plans and pursuits that prey upon us. Lord of resurrection, may we be raised into rhythms of your new life, dead to deceitful calendars, dead to fleeting friend requests, dead to the empty peace of our accomplishments. To our packed full planners, we bid peace. To our over-caffeinated consciences, we say, cease. To our suffocating selves, Lord, grant us release. Drowning in a sea of deadlines and death chimes, we rest in you, our lifeline. By your ever-restful grace, allow us to enter your Sabbath rest as your Sabbath rest enters into us. In the name of our Creator, our Liberator, our resurrection and life, we pray. Amen.
Hi everyone, my name is Andrea and I am the director over at St. Paul's. This morning I'm here to talk to you about rest. Now I'm sure everyone slept last night and they woke up and they feel rested, but sometimes we need to find rest with Jesus, real rest. Today, the idea of rest can sometimes be foreign to us, like we don't understand, but Jesus promises that rest in him. In Matthew 11, 28 to 30, he says, "Come to me, all who are weary and who are carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy, and my burden is light." Now this passage and from the Bible means that at any time, at any moment in the day, whether we are worried about a test or a sport that we're playing or we're having problems with a friend or we're not feeling well, anything, we can trust in God and know that he is giving us everything that we need. He promises that we can find rest in him. So if you, when you're feeling anxious or worried or anything, you can just take a moment and pause and pray and ask God to help you, and he will be there. He promises that he will be there for us, and we can find rest in him. Sometimes it's really hard because we all are really busy every day. We're running around and we just can't seem to find another moment in the day. But God is with us through everything, and we can find rest in him always. And he promises that. Let's bow our heads and have a quick prayer before we end our children's message. Dear Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for everything that you have given us each and every day. And thank you for your promise that we can find rest in you and with you whenever we need it. I pray that you help us to all have a wonderful day and remember that you are with us all day long. In your name we pray, amen. Thank you all for joining me, and hopefully I'll be back again another time. Have a great day, and remember to find rest in Jesus.
Today's scripture reading is Matthew verses 11, 16 to 19, and 25 to 30. I'm reading from the New Revised Standard Version. But to what will I compare this generation? Is it like children sitting in the marketplaces and calling to one another? We played the flute for you, and you did not dance. We wailed, and you did not mourn. For John came neither eating nor drinking, and they say, he has a demon. The Son of Man came eating and drinking, and they say, look, a glutton and a drunkard, a friend of tax collectors and sinners. Yet wisdom is vindicated by her deeds. At that time, Jesus said, I thank you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you've hidden these things from the wise and the intelligent and have revealed them to infants. Yes, Father, for such was your gracious will. All things have been handed over to me by my Father, and no one knows the Son except the Father, and no one knows the Father except the Son, and anyone to whom the Son chooses to reveal him. Come to me, all you that are weary and carrying heavy burdens, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn from me, for I am gentle and humble in heart, and you will find rest for your souls. For my yoke is easy and my burden is light. May the Holy Spirit lead us in our understanding and response to this scripture.
And now would you join me for a silent prayer? O Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts across the distances that separate us and the screens which connect us be acceptable unto you, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Promises, promises. Today and over the next few weeks, we want to talk about promises. Have you ever broken a promise? I think we all have, at one time or another. There's a funny story about a mother and a father returning home to a babysitter after a date night out, and when they come home and enter into the living room, all seems quiet. The babysitter is sitting comfortably, reading a book. The parents ask how the night went, and the babysitter, putting on her coat, reports that all went well and that the children are all settled and sleeping. And then after she has said her goodbyes, and just as she's about to close the door, she abruptly reports, oh, the only way I could get Sammy to stay in bed was to promise that if he stayed in bed and went to sleep, you'd be buying him a pony in the morning. Good night. We all hate the idea of broken promises. And we've seen many promises broken, from presidents to faith leaders, from parents to children, that we are often very cautious to believe that a promise will actually be fulfilled. But when God makes a promise, our faith calls us to rest in it, to cling with trust in belief in it, that God doesn't break a promise. Over the next 4 weeks, we're going to use the lectionary, that schedule of scripture readings spread out over a three-year period, looking at one of the texts from the lectionary each week to see what kind of promises God has made to us and how we might be able to rest in those promises. And the first promise, the one we're looking at this week, is about, well, rest. We heard it in our reading from the Gospel of Matthew, where Jesus is talking to the crowds. He says a word about how infants, that is how little children, can somehow make sense of his message in a way that adults maybe can't. Why is that, I wonder? I mean, much of what Jesus said, it cannot be denied, is rather upside down and inside out. He often said things that stood in opposition to conventional wisdom. I mean, he talked about elevating the lowly and bringing down the lofty. He talked about servants being the greatest. He gave his time to misfits and marginalized people, and he often chastised the popular people. He associated with Samaritans and with so-called sinners. He loved the unlovable. He forgave the thieves. He challenged people in power who had prestige and privilege. And he blessed people with baggage, with brokenness. He did things backwards so often, and this message was often confusing and is still confusing to us today as we continue to explore his life to try and understand God, because he is, as the scriptures remind us, the very image of the invisible God. I mean, that is, if we want to see God, if we want to understand God, then we look at Jesus. But to be honest, sometimes we aren't sure we understand Jesus. In fact, in 1 Corinthians 1, we read that the cross is like foolishness to the world, and that God has made foolish the wisdom of the world. So what seems foolish is actually wisdom, and the wisdom of God is like foolishness to humanity. In other words, in a world that values power and strength and military might and financial prowess and good looks and the kind of power that you can use to kind of cover up your brokenness and your scars and your failures, the message of Jesus in this kind of world seems utterly foolish. I mean, it's a message of love and forgiveness. It's a message of being open about our brokenness. It's a message in which the meek are blessed and the grieving are honored. It's a message of accepting all of God's people. A message brought home most powerfully by the story of a foreigner, a Samaritan, an other who is called good, who loves his neighbor. Our text in Matthew, then, reminds us that this message of love is a message that is confusing and confounding, and that actually makes more sense to children than to adults. I mean, children haven't had as much of a chance to be poisoned with the slow drip of hate and fear and cynicism that fills us over the years. And children, who are often the recipients of unconditional love, see no reason not to give that same kind of love to others, whatever their differences may be. Now, I'm not suggesting that children are perfect or completely unselfish, not at all. But I am saying that they are more predisposed toward an attitude of acceptance of the other. I mean, I've always seen this in children's ministry, in youth groups, and in church work. My experience has been that children are always more welcoming than the teenagers, who are also always more welcoming than the adults. It seems that the older we get, the more foolish becomes the message of the cross, that message of unmerited, reckless love that we talked about last week. And the more foolish that becomes to us, the more work it takes to remember that message, to cling to it, to lean into it. And after a while, many of us become exhausted. Are you tired? I've heard over and over again throughout this pandemic that many of you are tired. I get it. I'm tired too. And sometimes, even though we feel like we haven't done much of anything, we're still tired. I mean, maybe we're not going to as many appointments, or maybe we're not running to so many practices and meetings, but we still feel tired, worn out, exhausted even. We've had to process so much information in these last few months. I mean, think about all that we've had to reckon with A virus, a pandemic, a moving threat covering the globe, a daunting death count, countries shutting down, an effort to flatten the curve, uncertainty and more uncertainty, conspiracy theories, reopening phases, and then Ahmaud Arbery and George Floyd and Breonna Taylor and others in the national spotlight, a long history of racism in our structures and systems finally being brought to center stage in a new way, and still the virus, numbers still rising in parts of the world and perhaps even here at home also. It's no wonder we are exhausted. And in the middle of this, I want to invite you to hear this promise from Jesus. He says, "Come to me, all who are weary, and you will find rest." You will find rest. Friends, this isn't just a promise for physical rest. I mean, there may be some times in our lives when we are particularly physically exhausted, and we may have felt like somehow God provided space or quiet or time for physical rest for us. And that's real. But I think Jesus is talking about something even bigger here. I mean, sometimes my kids are lying around not doing much of anything, especially in the summertime, and I'll say, you know, "What's wrong?" And they'll say, "I'm bored." "Well, why don't you go do something?" "I'm tired." "You're tired? What are you tired from? What have you done today?" "Nothing." And while that sounds ridiculous, I know that's a thing that happens to all of us. Like, we do this. Boredom and apathy and listlessness get all sort of wrapped up and can easily look or feel something like exhaustion. But it's not the same thing. In fact, what some of us may need, at least in some moments of our lives, is a rest from our own boredom or our own apathy. But for many others of us, or at other times in our lives, we truly are tired. I mean, we're just tired. We're tired from our emotional anxiety. We're tired from stress in our relationships. We're tired from our jobs. We're tired of worry, tired of fighting for justice, tired of trying to live into this radical foolishness of the cross in which God calls us to love and forgive our neighbors, even those with whom we disagree. It's tiring. We're exhausted. And if this is you in any way, I want you to hear God's promise to you today. "Come to me, and I will give you rest." Come to me. This sounds like it may relate to this last month, this journey of prayer we've been on, as an opportunity for us to come to God, to enter into moments of connection with God, to engage in more profound and in deeper ways in our relationship with God, to come to Jesus. Jesus says, "Come to me, and I will give you rest." Now, the word for rest here is anapausis, and it can mean Sabbath rest. It can mean rest from war, when the enemies are defeated and the weapons are laid down and finally one can rest. It can refer to the rest of death, and it's sometimes even used as an image of salvation. The kind of rest when everything is finally set to rights and all things can enjoy a full and complete Sabbath restoration. You know, when all is as it should be. Maybe you know this feeling of rest. And sometimes when I lay down to fall asleep at night, things are not as they should be. Things aren't all in their right place and my mind is scattered and jumbled and I have trouble falling asleep. And when I do fall asleep and find some rest that night, often it's not good rest. I wake up still tired. This kind of rest, this anapausis, is when all is in its right place, when things are as they should be, when we can breathe easy and say all will be well. This is the promise that Jesus offers us. "Come to me, and I will give you rest." Not a short nap. Jesus isn't offering us a coddling relief from our apathetic boredom or our adherence to the status quo. No, no. What Jesus offers is a real respite to those who are doing the hard work of living into the foolishness of the cross. Hope, healing, restoration, service, humility, justice, mercy, and love. It may take many shapes. And whether that's the work of racial justice or relational healing or environmental awareness or serving the poor or teaching our children or building bridges with marginalized groups or whatever it might be, Jesus offers you an invitation to come to him where you will find rest, the kind of rest we associate with all things being as they should, with all being well. He actually makes this image even more clear by inviting us to come and take his yoke. What an interesting image, right? A yoke is usually a symbol of work, not rest. It sounds like Jesus is inviting us into the field for some labor. But he says, my yoke is easy. Now, the Greek word that's translated there as easy can also be translated, and some translators argue that here at least a better translation might be the word good. My yoke is good. That this is good work. Now, I'm inviting you into something that may seem foolish to you, but it's good work. It's rewarding work. It's the right work. It's the necessary work. It's the kind of work that really satisfies your soul and brings a sense of meaning and value. Yes, it can be exhausting, but it can be life-giving also. This isn't the kind of work that feels like a hamster on a wheel. It's not just, you know, just punching your card or getting in the machine to earn a paycheck. Friends, Jesus says, I have this message. I have this way that is just crazy enough to be hard work for you to even understand or believe or live out. In fact, it feels like utter foolishness to most of you. It's about radical, upside-down, inside-out love for all. But if you do the work of believing in it, if you do the work of having faith like a child, if you do the work of wanting to share this real love with everyone around you, if you come to me in this way, you will find real rest for your soul. When you work to eradicate racism in your own heart or in your community, you're taking the yoke of Jesus, doing good work, and you'll find rest in there too. When you work to restore broken relationships, when you engage in serving others in humility without an agenda, when you do the work of relationship building, especially with those who are different than you, then you are doing the hard work of Jesus. And to be honest, this yoke isn't easy most of the time. It certainly isn't simple. It's messy and hard and exhausting. But it is good. It is right. And it connects us to the Son of God, Jesus Christ, who gives us real rest for our souls. How is it with your souls, my friends? Are you tired? Are you worn out from fighting your own demons, from struggling with your own addictions, from sitting with your own apathy? Are you learning about your participation in systems of injustice? Are you tired from struggling under the weight of those systems that have marginalized or oppressed you in some way? Are you tired from trying to earn favor or forgiveness? Are you worn out from spinning your own wheels and seeing no end in sight? My friends, come to Jesus. In him, you will find rest for your souls. In him, you find that the work for justice, the labor for love, is life-giving and sustaining. It is good and it is right. And in him, you will find resurrection where you feel dead. You will find life abundantly. You'll find home. You'll find rest. May it be so for you in this season. Amen. Let us pray together. God, in times of weakness and in hour of need, yours is the strength by which we carry on. Yours is the shoulder we rest our head upon. When our load is heavy and too much to bear, yours are the arms stretched out to help us and the grace that we depend on. Lord, it's in these moments that we hear your voice calling, come, come to me, find rest in me. Oh God, we thank you for this grace. Whatever the source of our exhaustion of body, of mind, or spirit, we long for your perfect rest. We long to come to you, to be a part of your kingdom work which truly satisfies us. We want to be a part of building the thing you are building in us and among us and through us. We want to experience a holy exhaustion that is a result of being your hands and feet in a world which so desperately needs you. Teach us to come to you, to take your yoke, to experience your rest, and to build your kingdom as you taught us when you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who have trespassed against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Now let us sing together our closing hymn.
For me, see your
calm, to be at peace, to be at rest with Him, to be able to experience the mercies, the love, the forgiveness that Jesus desires for all of God's children. When we are so blessed in so many ways, we can do nothing but respond with gratitude in sharing our blessings with others. We have some opportunities coming up. One of the things that we can do is to bring food donations to the SPIF, St. Paul's Youth Fellowship Group, as they collect food for the State College Food Bank on Sunday, July 12th, between 6 and 8 p.m. in our own parking lot. That is one of the ways in which we can respond to God. Another way, the shoe bank will be opening shortly. There is always a need for Saturday morning volunteers. It's a couple hours. You could do that once a month or have one of your groups sign up to say that you'll cover the first Saturday of every month, which means that if you have a group of 10 of you, you would each just be doing it maybe once a year. One of the other ways in which we can respond to God's love and care and grace that is showered and bestowed upon us is also through our tithes and our offerings. Thank you for the incredibly faithful and generous support which you continue to provide so that all of the ministries and missions at St. Paul's United Methodist Church and Wesley Foundation can continue. As we say, we may not be worshiping together, but the church is not closed. And we thank you for all the ways in which your financial gifts help others to come to Jesus, to know Jesus, and to come home.
And now we offer you this benediction, this good word to send you into your week. Go as those who have been met by God in this time together and who are being made into faithful followers of Jesus Christ, and as those who are moved by the Holy Spirit. Go and meet new people and make real relationships and move into new expressions of love and service as you take the next steps on your pathway. Go as those who are finding rest for your souls in the good work of following Jesus towards love and justice. Go in peace.